principals with the London Symphony for 9 years. Nearly 175 concerts a year of all kinds.
It seems to be that cottage is fractionally too soon.
Over 400 rehearsal sessions a year. We make more long-playing records than any other orchestra in the world. For the LSO to survive, it's severed labour. Of all the halls that we have to work in, for me, Wembley Town Hall is one of the most convenient. It's only 20 minutes from home. So I'm very happy that the Philips recording engineers like the acoustics of this hall. It just suits me fine. When we arrive at work, we're all feeling in a pretty routine frame of mind. Our mood is very soon set by the type of music which we're going to work on. A great deal of our time is spent in recordings because this is a very lucrative form of employment. It is the monies from these recordings which largely contribute to the success of our concerts, which of course are tremendously expensive, and the audience attendance in no way covers the cost of them. Very often we have periods, 6 weeks, even 2 months, without a free day. If it were not for the knowledge that we have to do this in order to survive as an artistic body, we couldn't stand the pace for a week. Although you wouldn't think it, we're all shareholders in the London Symphony Orchestra, which is a non-profit-making company. That is, if there were any profits. The whole responsibility for the running of the orchestra, for its artistic and financial success, is the orchestra member's duty. My ambition has always been to belong to a great symphony. More satisfying than making music with such a large group of fine players. For me, this isn't just another day of work, because we're doing the Enigma variations, and Colin Davis is an outstanding interpreter of the music of Elgar.
When one arrives to work with an orchestra, whether it's a recording session or a concert, you get in, you wonder how the orchestra are going to be. Are they going to be worn out? Are they going to want to play? Are they not going to want to play? Are they going to hate the sight of you? All these things race through one's mind. You meet somebody who says, "Hello, how are you?" And it's on. You've started. And you are then living hundreds of times faster. You may not even want to do it. You may be able to start in again. And yet when you...
Gentlemen,
Stuart
Knussen. There are two announcements, gentlemen. The booking for our concerts on February 12th, 14th and 16th is very heavy indeed.
Our General Secretary, Ernest Fleischmann, has a tremendous responsibility arranging tours, concerts, rehearsal schedules. Without him, I think, the orchestra would collapse.
In May, the dates are, we leave here on the morning of the 18th of May and we'll be back here on the morning of the 2nd of June.
morning, gentlemen.
For the conductor, when he feels that the members of the orchestra he's conducting are somehow, that there is some affinity, they ask of the music an enhancement of life. And that's where they get it from this corporate attempt to produce something marvellous. I can't explain this any other way. I don't know the members of the London Symphony Orchestra individually very well. I don't know, for instance, Stuart Knussen very well, but I know that when he's on the platform, that he's absolutely... he's not only underneath the thing with his bass in the sound, but he's with you and coming along with you, and you've only got to glance at him and he will suddenly produce a sort of noise. He relishes, a man like that relishes the music. This is a strength which is impossible to describe. If you don't have it, you might get a good performance. If you do have it, you suddenly get something which lifts it further. Even somebody who may not be important at the back desk of the violins, you suddenly, somebody just half closes an eye to know that he knows and you know that you're going to do something. Then you cease to be just yourself trying to make people do things. You are both part of something which is happening.
I think we should diminuendo at the end of the second bar of one, as I think we should the second bar from the beginning. It isn't marked. But I think we should a little. Then he goes up again. For the fifth and sixth bar, it goes right over. Is it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? Then diminuendo.
I think it is astonishing that people can work so many hours and still produce first-class performances.
It's the acid. And all these crotchet rests are only a breath in the tune. Too ginger. Please turn, don't make it into bug. Come in, please, otherwise poor old Empire totters again.
And they must have a very clever way of dealing with themselves.
Bigger one.
Of not getting angry if they don't like the conductor. Of not being irritated by the man they've been sitting next to for 5 years.
Piece of music, the more difficult it is to give maximum power to the performance, so that in recording the tension builds up tremendously, so we have to seize every opportunity to relax immediately, if only for 30 seconds.
With the last variation.
The tension is so great, particularly with fine conductors, that if we were not able to do this, we wouldn't be able to continue recording at the rate that we do.
And then into the finale, with the light.
All right.
cheerful. Would you give us an A?
Their qualities as nerve. They can let energy loose. It has this kind of corporate attack and fire, which is what has put it where it is. The LSO has got this quality, I think, because they have enough people individually who've got it, that the people in the key positions have got that. A quality which raises the living temperature. Because what they all want is to produce something out of the ordinary. And each individual of the orchestra can make his own contribution to this raising of the temperature. Perfectly well that I have respect for them. Presumably they have some for me, otherwise they wouldn't ask me to work with them. But although you know nothing about these people's private lives, there may be a very intimate relationship which has no words attached to it, which only exists while you are playing the music. But you do meet through the music, and you never say a word. You may not know what he thinks about Mr. Wilson or President Johnson, but you know very well what he feels about their death. And you know perfectly well that he thinks Berlioz is more important. We'll be right back.
coffee break acts as a marvellous safety valve. It's one of the important union rules which govern recording sessions. We all belong to the Musicians' Union. I'm afraid we're rather apathetic members because we're working at such pressure that we really can't find time to go to union meetings.
They did a film about it.
I copied it onto black and white, is it?
Getting on?
Yes.
Very well, indeed.
So recording for an orchestra is easier because it has to concentrate hard for shorter spaces of time. For the conductor, it is more of a strain, I think, because he's got to keep an eye on the clock. He's got to get it in. And if he doesn't get it in, it's his fault, not the orchestra.
I think you've run out. Two more copies, please.
Lord Mariner.
Oh, he's out.
Lord Mariner's conducting the orchestra concert. He has to be busy.
Mariner's conducting.
He's conducting this, St. Martin's song.
I've already paid two and eight pence too.
No, I beg pardon.
Playing music, one does live at a very, very much higher pace than almost anything else that one does at all. This is why musicians are difficult people, because of this strain.
Yes,
it's a bit of a strain and a joy of concentration. And it's something to do with the element of time, that it has to be now. It's no good it being there a little bit out. Either music is right or it's wrong. There's another awful thing about it. It's not sort of kind of right, or perhaps a little bit right. It's either hopelessly wrong or miraculous. And the attempt to make it miraculously right demands this nervous concentration.
Good.
But a musician who is really aware is aware of what somebody's doing 6 feet away. And he knows when to blow, when that man's going to blow. It doesn't always happen, but when it happens, the result is so incredibly satisfying. This accounts for everything about their lives, I think. Why it's so exciting and why it's so tedious.
It's impossible to describe the effect that a conductor has on an orchestra, except that for a fine conductor we play better. I believe by their personality, by their musicianship, which comes from them in some
place. I see you from this point.
Not at all.
That's finished.
I played the Enigma Variation, I suppose, about 300 times. And although one might think that I would get rather bored with it after this time, believe me, I'd never get bored with playing music, no matter how many times I do it.
Many of us today in the orchestra are extremely worried about where we're going to get our new blood from to fill the various vacancies that occur from time to time. And I think one can only blame the colleges and the academies for this situation, because I feel that they have the wrong attitude. The powers that be who run these academies still are suffering from the delusion that orchestral playing is a second best for maybe a disappointed instrumentalist. And does someone like Sir Thomas Armstrong, who's principal of the Royal Academy of Music, tell his students when they arrive that the chances of their becoming successful soloists are extremely remote, to say the least.
Well, you must remember that when people come here and are selected as first study string players, they naturally have the anxiety, the determination to develop every potentiality that they have. And it would be wrong to restrict them to the possibility of orchestral playing, important as that is. They nearly all see themselves when they first start as possible soloists and concerto players or chamber music players. And we have to train them in a basic way to give them the equipment for any kind of orchestral or solo playing experience that may come their way.
These are days of extreme specialization. The technique that is required to play in a modern symphony orchestra is very considerable, and it's a rather specialized subject. To say that you are going to prepare a musician to be able to tackle any orchestral music or any solo work that may come his way is surely the wrong attitude. We should be producing people who are going out from the colleges to tackle a certain sphere of music extremely well, but in fact can offer a very interesting career.
You see, when a player has been in the orchestra for 5 years, you may be pretty sure that he's played the whole repertory, and he's played it under many conductors, and some of the conductors whom he's called to play with, he won't really respect as first-rate artists. And when he's played a symphony many, many, many times, he can do it in one or two or three ways. He can play it under a great artist who throws a flood of new light for him, even if he's getting on in years. Or he can give a routine performance, or he can give a performance which seems to him definitely harmful to his sense of what is right, you see, in music. Of course, when they're young, the glamour of going to play in Japan, in Russia, is wonderful. The glamour is strong, but people can't live on glamour for more than a number of years if they're good artists. The time comes when they say to themselves, where do I go from here? And am I getting better? Or am I not as good as I was 3 years ago? Of course, if you're a first oboe, if you're a first horn, you have a wonderful opportunity for your individual achievement as an artist. But if you're playing at the third desk of the violins, you may be the finest orchestral player in the world, but it's very hard to capture this feeling of personal artistic achievement. And this is what needs to be done to build up the kind of feeling which will attract the best players.
I think it is a very mistaken attitude of the musical authorities today to feel that it is boring to play in an orchestra after you've got over the first flash of glamour or interest, and to say that after a mere 5 years of playing in an orchestra, you have played the repertoire is, I think, absolute nonsense. The LSO today is an extremely busy orchestra. In actual fact, it's far too busy, but that is a different problem altogether. Our concert policy, our programs policy, is an extremely adventurous one, and we make more gramophone records probably than any other orchestra in the world. And so we cover an enormous area of orchestral music. It is a much more rewarding life, surely, to play these masterpieces with, for the most part, the finest possible conductors than to be trotting around on tour perpetually as maybe a third-class soloist with a handful of works. Of course, our most pressing problem today is this one of finding sufficient first-class string players, of which there's an extreme shortage. It is a very sad thing that there are fewer orchestras nowadays for young people to get their early years of experience in. But surely the main reason, as far as this country is concerned, is that the students come to the colleges far too late and stay for far too short a period. To start your really serious musical training at, say, the age of 16 is just the time when you should be putting the final touches onto a very rigorous training, and not to be starting a specialized musical course.
We wish it could be 5 years or 6 years, and we wish it could start earlier. And these are matters which, within the course of the next 20 years, our educational system will have to deal. You see the beginnings of this in the schools of music that are being privately organized by people like Yehudi Menuhin and the Central Tutorial School and Dr. Ruth Railton. And these are all attempts to bring the experience down to a lower age and to get the musical training started earlier in life. As you know, this is done in many other countries. It's done in Russia, it's done in Hungary, and it's done to a large extent in France too. Because in these countries, they accept the musical profession as a magnificent activity for any human being and as a fine kind of education. The ordinary English person says, well, you've got to educate these boys and girls first and then train them to be musicians. I absolutely disagree with this. You can educate them by music with other subjects.
My father would not allow me to go to one of the institutes of musical learning in England because he thought that it would be a waste of time. A child must begin his musical training at a very early age before he realizes that it is a form of training. Oliver first showed an interest in music when he was a baby. By the time he's just developed from here, so that by now he's a very accomplished musician. At home, my son just treats me as a fellow musician, which is very good for him, and I think very good for me too.
Right. Okay, shall we go on to the next
one? Okay. Right, shall I start?
Wrap it up. Faster.
Okay. When he went to the grammar school, he had a very unhappy time because his interests were not those of the other boys, and because of this, he underwent a tremendous amount of teasing. One of the best things that I have ever done was to send Oliver to the Central Tutorial College for Young Musicians. Music is only taught as a normal school subject, and the school curriculum is the same as in any other school. By the time he leaves school, he will have had the opportunity to decide which field of music he is going to go in for. Not only this, but will have had tremendous amount of practical experience in this field.
Still too long?
Oh, it'll do, I suppose.
Righto, okay. Well, how are the rehearsals going at Morley College?
What, for the concert?
Yes, sir.
No, the rehearsals are going fine. Only the music isn't.
Why? Well, what don't you like about it?
I don't know.
Well, I mean, maybe you wrote it far too difficult for the standard of the people.
It's not far too difficult for the standard.
Mm. Is that the one where Huey sings?
No, that's the one where Huey sings. That's okay.
Yeah.
Only I altered that a lot. So that's this one, I suppose, is the best movement. With the choir, but without the harp, because the harp tends to have the brownies.
Well, I want to be a composer, if possible, and a conductor.
But I'll show you.
One of the important things about music is building up a proper relationship to your fellow musicians, understanding their problems. This is a very difficult thing to learn, and it becomes a second nature to you if you go to a school for young musicians like the Central. tutorial school. It sort of grows on you, whereas if you just suddenly go to the academy when you're 16, you find it very hard to learn.
The clarinet's got to play it, and the guitar's got to play it.
Continually switching from this kind of miraculous magic world where your concentration is entirely absorbed to the exclusion of everything else to another world where it doesn't matter at all. That kind of intensity is not what's required. And to go from one to the other, I find sometimes frightfully difficult. But it's a discipline one has to learn. And if you don't learn it, you exhaust yourself unnecessarily. And the big technique of being a musician is being able to drop it like that, to switch on sorrow, happiness, power, grandeur, and switch it off again. Because although these moments of, these ecstatic moments of music are so exciting, you can't live like this for very long. You go completely mad. It's the tragedy of most of us. Big and small, that we love this kind of intensity. We go on until we get exhausted, and then we feel absolutely terrible.
Meetings are one of our more important activities, very strong attendance. Barry Tuckwell is our first horn, and though I don't know, he's also chairman of our board of directors.
We not only have to decide our own musical problems, we have got to decide all the financial things as well. Money is an enormous worry to us. If we play to a capacity house at the festival hall, we still lose money. We lose a lot. This money has to come from somewhere. We get a large amount from public funds, from private individuals, and from commercial bodies. Without these, we'd be an orchestra that just plays concerts for money. These would be, with one rehearsal, always of the most popular works. And this is absolute certain death to an orchestra artistically. It looks now as if we are public funds. But even if we were to receive double, we would still need a vast amount of money in addition to this to keep the standard of musical activity.
Gentlemen, could you come and sit down? We'll start the meeting now.
The orchestra has just made, for us, one of the most important decisions in our history, the decision to appoint a new principal conductor to succeed the late Pierre Monteur. And Ernest and I were sent over to Cologne to speak to Kertész. Mr. van Kertész will be only the seventh conductor to hold this position. He's a conductor we've worked with very closely for many years. The orchestra overwhelmingly decided to ask Curtis to accept the post, and we had to be very careful to explain the conditions of the appointment. Perhaps this is a unique position for a musical director, because the LSO has always and will continue over all financial and artistic points.
I would like to know really and exactly how much power I have as a principal conductor.
Good question. Well, what is power? The situation is very much our problem.
Well, in practice, isn't it, if Mr. Curtis is dissatisfied with a certain player, he will doubtless tell the board.
But surely, won't we also be?
Well, yes, this is your point.
Yes.
Now, I mean, this is the sort of problem that we have to face, and we take it very seriously.
What happens if a soloist, I mean a piano player for a piano concerto, and if you engage or you want to have somebody with whom I'm not
in sympathy?
Yes. Can I tell no? Conduct this concert.
Look, we've never forced a soloist onto a conductor.
Yes.
A conductor when the conductor was really in disagreement about the choice.
And in the other hand, is another question. When I want to have somebody, a young man or a young lady from Germany or from Italy, or you don't know the name, you have never heard, can I bring him or her
to
the concert?
I don't think we've ever taken anybody's recommendation at face value without in some way checking up for ourselves or with reliable contacts. Isn't that right?
Even if it is my concert, the concert for the principal conductor, I have the responsibility.
If we thought that you were the sort of person who would just inflict anybody or everybody on us just at your whim, we wouldn't have wanted you as our principal conductor.
I was very pleased when I heard the news that Mr. Curtis was taken over as principal conductor of the LSO. He's a fine man, I understand, a very, very fine musician. Now, I've been working for the LSO 9 years. But actually, I feel as if I one of them, and I'm made to feel that way. Instead of playing an instrument, I drive the van, set the platform up, and other little jobs that may crop up.
There's only the five bass today, isn't there?
Yes, leave those other two for an important.
Most of the instruments are very expensive. For instance, the four timpani cost about £1,500. Beautiful instruments. And then the Stuart Knussen's bass. I suppose that cost him nearly £1,000 to buy. One or two members of the orchestra I know, their fiddle's worth about £1,200 each. We do a fantastic mileage each year with the instruments. We have to dodge around London to different rehearsal places, sometimes two, three times a day. I think it worries the players themselves quite a bit. I just don't know how they stand it. They must be absolutely on the knees at the end of a day.
Public concert is the climax of every musician's career. No matter how often concerts are given, each concert has its own particular feeling of preparation and of anticipation.
London Symphony Orchestra has built itself a very fine reputation over the last 10 years. Because of this, people are prepared to accept that we will put on a good performance of a good piece of music. Nowadays, it's possible to put on a complete program of modern music and still be sure of a fairly full house. And this used to be the prerogative of Tchaikovsky. This particular concert is a special interest to all of us because it's István Kertész's first concert since the announcement of his appointment to the position principal conductor of the London Symphony Orchestra.
Thank you.
Enjoy yourself.
We try our best.
This will be one of the last concerts that Eric Grünberg appears as leader of the LSO. He's leaving us to further his career as a soloist. It's difficult to say what I get nervous about because, I mean, I know the symphony from memory. I know that Kertész is going to give a tremendous interpretation of it. And what I have to do is play my part as I know that he wants it. And I know that everybody else feels the same way. Once this feeling is achieved in an orchestra, Beethoven's Seventh Symphony is one of the most startling works to listen to and to perform.
Thank you.
feeling at the end of such a performance is a mixture of tremendous elation and tiredness. Obviously, we've been hard at it, particularly in the finale, which is very, very taxing physically. It'll take many cups of coffee to allow us to simmer down to normal. The performance of a great work under these conditions is our principal reward for all the hard preparation and worry and practice that we have to do. It makes our life worth living and means that we've achieved what all our years of training have been for. The important thing is that the audience are left with a wonderful memory of a wonderful performance. It's not important for them to know that tomorrow morning we're back at work recording.